in a second, but first, couple of big plays you might have missed from last night. Bucks, Thunder, Paul George all over Giannis.
Listen, Paul George got him there, and Giannis got blocked at the rim at least, I think, twice in this game. Go get it, PG-13.
Good game last night. OKC looked good at home.
Man, some really good NBA games last night. It was our first Sunday without football in 20 weeks. The NBA picked up the slack for us.
Ooh, Mavs, Raptors, Luka Doncic finds Dennis Smith Jr. for the alley and the...
That was one of Luka's double-digit assists. Luka Doncic is now the only teenager in NBA history with multiple triple-doubles. And DSJ trying to get his name off the trade block after a little disappointed start to the season.
Yeah, very good news for Mavs fans there. Dennis Smith Jr. playing well.
Lakers and Suns. Devin Booker drives to the basket, gets fouled. Somehow, though, gets it to drop.
Ooh. I hope one day the NBA fans get a chance to see Devin Booker playing for a win. Now, you talking about a shot maker, someone who can score the ball? He's like Klay Thompson who can dribble.
I'll tell you this. The Suns, as inept as they've been, him plus DeAndre Ayton, who's been overshined by Luka but's been really good, and they're going to have another top five pick, you'd imagine. They might actually have found their way into a core.
All right, more from this game. Rajon Rondo, a lot of minutes last night, pulls off the Michael Jordan-like aerial stunt right there.
He's got those huge hands now. That's what he's legendary for, besides a mean disposition.
I thought when he took off, I was like, is Rondo trying to dunk this? But no, this is more Rondo's speed right there.
When he took off, I thought he was D. Brown. Then he turned back into Rondo.
Man, that would have been a bad loss for the Lakers to the Suns. It's good they have Rondo back. Speaking of them.
Speaking of them, LeBron remains sidelined with that groin injury, the first substantial injury of his career. He's been out over a month already, but reportedly still having a big impact on the organization. There is a growing belief that LeBron's camp is not happy with head coach Luke Walton. Lakers are 26-24 with the ninth place record in the conference. Nick, is Luke Walton the right fit for LeBron and the Lakers?
I do not know, and nobody knows. Anybody that claims to have the strongest of opinions on this, I believe, is misleading themselves. We have not seen this team at full strength, but for a dozen games all year. We have not seen Luke Walton coach a team with real expectations, aside from the interim stint with the Warriors in the 73-win season ever. And you can make, I think I could be the prosecutor or the defense on this argument. If I wanted to get rid of Luke Walton, I would talk about the lack of growth of the players. I would talk about the stagnation of guys that we thought were blue chippers. And I would talk about the lack of what I think is creativity on some sidelines, out of bounds, and after timeouts plays where the best coaches can really make their money. And if I were defending him, I'd say, okay, how many guys in the league would do well when their best player's out a month, when he's never been hurt, when Rondo's been hurt twice this year, when a guy got suspended early in Ingram, Lonzo is dinged, Kuzma's playing with a bad hip. Like, what do you want? This team was in fourth place beating the Warriors when LeBron got hurt. So I just think the jury is not even, it hasn't even gone to the jury yet. It's not even that they're still out. We need more time. This is Luke Walton's first major season as a head coach with real expectations, and there are parts of it that I've been impressed by and parts of it that have been concerning. But I also don't buy that LeBron is trying to push him out. This was said on a podcast by someone who doesn't cover the Lakers. Jackie McMullen's an excellent reporter, but she's more East Coast centric. If Brian Windhorst or Zach Lowe or Woj or Shams or one of the many Lakers reporters wrote this, then I would take it with more than a grain of salt that I'm taking it right now.
Well, there were questions about Luke Walton. And ultimately, we know, regardless of what's going on in the NBA, LeBron, besides the Warriors, LeBron's going to get blamed for it. So before LeBron even got there, there were question marks about Luke Walton that were fair. And they would have been fair to any NBA coach. One of the things, when you don't have a chance to win a championship and you have lottery picks on your roster, one of the things in weighing judging a coach beside what do they do, dead ball, timeout, situations like that, what do they do, is are there younger players developing?
Yeah.
Now, one of the issues that I believe is worth discussing is when the players don't develop, we always blame the coach. You know why? Because we don't like to blame the players. But the players are more at fault with lack of development than the coaches are. Because the coaches are trying to develop the players, but Are they putting in the necessary work to make themselves better? We always blame the coach. Wherever LeBron has been, the coach has always been in question. The only thing happened in Miami where he had Pat Riley, who would not budge, and he was not coaching LeBron. He was not going to replace Eric Spoelstra, who was an unproven coach at the time. But LeBron believed in Dwayne Wade, and Dwayne Wade told him that Sproles was a good and up-and-coming coach, and he could trust him. Every other season, almost, LeBron's been in the NBA. The coach has been in question. The big thing is now the Lakers have to make sure they don't lose patience. Don't forget what the model was. The model was about the summer of 2019. And we didn't know 50 games in with a record at 26-24, LeBron missing a month. Because if we're being fair to Luke Walton with all that happening, this wouldn't be a question. They would continue with the season because LeBron has missed the month. And all the lack of player development, that's not on Luke Walton. Kuzma's developing. So how's Kuzma developing in Lonzo? He's not developing as fast. Ingram's not developing as fast. Is that really all Luke Walton's fault? So I just believe, be patient. Don't forget what the plan was. The plan was about the summer of 2019, and we're still headed towards that.
And I just think there's a false narrative surrounding LeBron and coach killer. LeBron was drafted by a team where Paul Silas was the coach. Paul Silas, a year and a half in, Cleveland moved on from him and hired Mike Brown. Mike Brown was the coach the rest of LeBron's time there. Then he went to Miami. Spo was the coach the entire time there. Then he went to Cleveland, where they had hired David Blatt to deal with a young, not championship anywhere close team, and LeBron signs with them. And Blatt, a year and a half, I think with a lot of LeBron's pushing, was out the door.
But also, before they hired Blatt, they hired Ty Lue, made him before they hired Blatt. So Blatt inherited Ty Lue, and they made Ty Lue the highest paid assistant. So when you start a situation like that, typically it's not going to end well.
And so the evidence is, it's not like people were lining up to hire David Blatt after that. It's not like David Blatt, it's like, oh, you fired this great coach. Two coaches have been fired under LeBron's watch. Paul Silas, who didn't get another job for 5 years, and then when he got it, it was in Charlotte, short-lived. And David Blatt, who will never coach in the NBA again. Like, there's always tension because they talk about LeBron so much. And with Spo, it was touch and go for a moment. But they were smart to keep Eric Spoelstra because he proved himself to be an excellent NBA coach. But there's not this long list of coaches left in LeBron's wake. The only one that you can directly say LeBron helped get fired was David Blatt. And it was the right decision. They won the championship right that year with Ty Lue as the head coach.
There's a report out now that the Lakers are looking to hire or to bring someone in, another superstar, another big star to help LeBron before the trade deadline in the NBA. What do you make of that?
All right, so I don't know how this is possible. Like, unless they think they're getting Anthony Davis, which the trade deadline's in 10 days, spoiler alert, they're not. There's no one that you would give up your ability to sign Kawhi Leonard or Kyrie Irving in free agency to bring in. There's that second tier Bradley Beal level star. So,
right.
If they're going to make a trade, it's going to be for guys like this: Thad Young, Vucevic, Bojan Bogdanovic, guys that are on expiring contracts that you would include Kentavious Caldwell-Pope and a first-round pick to bring them in and keep all your cap flexibility. It would be but not a star, like a C-lister in the NBA, like superstar, all-star in the tier beneath that. But I think you agree with me on this. You don't want to give up your flexibility for what you said the plan was this summer.
Yeah, and stay to the plan. Don't lose your patience just because you're inside the NBA season. Because Boston's not going to trade Kyrie to L.A.
No.
During the season in the next 10 days. And AD is not leaving the Pelicans until potentially this summer at the earliest. Remain patient. Get LeBron back healthy. Get the rest of the roster back healthy. Get into the playoffs. Try to win a series. Head to the summer and then try to land Kawhi, which I would do. I'd be trying to land Kawhi.
There are two names. Like, Kimball Walker's on expiring deal, but I do not think the Hornets want to move him. And Mark Gasol's an interesting one because he has a player option, but he is available. If he were to say, I'm going to turn down the player option, mm-hmm. so it becomes an expiring contract, that's that's a move they potentially could make. But I think they like how Zubats is playing, and all of a sudden they have a legitimate depth at center. But I don't see them bringing in anyone with a name bigger than Nikola Mirotic. Like, that's the level of player we're talking about.
They seem to only want to bring in names that CeCe and I would have a hard time pronouncing. Big night for Zubats last night, 24 points.
Absolutely.
Time now for Put a Grade On It, sponsored by CarMax. Lakers have three of their starting five out with injuries, but they still beat the Suns 116-102 last night. Brandon Ingram, 22 points. We've been watching him. Nick, put a grade on the Lakers without LeBron.
I'm going to give him a C-. I'd give him a better grade, but those losses to the Knicks and Cavs are absolutely unforgivable, and that's the reason they're not 8-8 instead of 6-10 during the break. So C-, not a total disaster, but worse than you would have hoped.
Yeah, it's hard to. They just barely passed. Barely passed.
Give him a D?
I don't consider a D a passing grade.
Oh, okay.
Because you got to be eligible. You got to be above a 2.0.
Oh, okay.
So don't try to come around here with no D's.
Standards in the Jordan.
Joyce Carter's not playing that. I'll go with the C-.
Okay.
All right, take a break. Coming up, can the Patriots slow down Todd Gurley? That's next. This is First Things First.
Austin, I'm going to give you a B. That was a better segment than the B than the A's. And the A's, you got, I'm not going to say what
good
you're great,
stage
but
manager.
You're better than the B. Nice. I'd like
Jenna, thanks for
you don't have a speaking role.
I don't know who he was.